all-new Yamaha YZ450F. Narrower, more compact, and lighter. Built to do one thing, go faster.
Hey, what's going on? Welcome to Swapmoto Live Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha. I'm Josh Hill, sitting here with my brother, Justin Hill. And I guess we're taking over Don's job today and we're going to be interviewing each other. So, Justin, you're back. Was it almost three years off racing? You became a cop. You worked at a tire shop. You wanted to be a rancher. Are you still wanting to be a rancher?
I'll still be a rancher, yeah.
So it's good to have you back. Are you pumped to be back racing? What's the deal?
No, slinging tires is sweet, but I'm pumped. Like, yeah, I missed it. I missed racing a ton. Every little piece of the night that, like, you know, gets you rolling and gets you excited, I miss that more than I thought I would. It used to make me nervous, and now I'm just stoked about it.
Sometimes you take a little time off. It helps you regain that love for racing. I know, like, for myself, there was times when racing is all you have and your only way to make money and you don't know anything else, it becomes a little bit of like, it takes the fun away from it, I guess. And you got to almost sometimes hit the reset button and realize how cool it is to do the things that we do. And I'm glad that you're still young and healthy enough to get a second shot at it. So you've got a 250 Supercross championship. You said in a lot of interviews that you're a 450 guy. What's your best 450 finish?
Not as good as yours.
Okay. So is that kind of one of the things eating at you to get back out there is show that you actually are indeed a 450 guy?
I'm just trying to put our name on the map, dude, and be the only brothers to win. That's really what I'm about.
I think the Stewart brothers are pretty.
They're closer at the moment.
I think that they're the fastest brothers. Unless you step up and you have to do a lot of damage before, like, James. Like, you can
offset of James
and Malcolm, and yeah.
Yeah, well, I don't know, man. At least I have a brother that, like, forces me to get back into racing so we can find out every time I'm, like, out of it and just out ranching and doing stuff. You're like, hey, what about this idea? All right, yeah, let's do it. It's dirt bike involvement. Big Hill GM got me stoked about riding, too. That was so much fun. I was like, I miss it. When we diced it up our hill, the same hill climb we've been doing since we were both like 13, and we actually like had an event and we get to battle up that was so sweet. I had so much fun doing that.
That was pretty fun. I mean, it was, I thought for sure, like, if I had a chance at beating you, it was going to be at that, because, like, I don't think you even looked at the hill. You say it's the same hill we went up since we were kids, but we added all these different obstacles and all these things to make it different, and I didn't think you were even going to ride. I thought you were just helping me with the water system, and I had gear laid out for you, had your bike all gone through, and, like, kind of forced you to get on it, and then you went out and smoked all of us. Scrubbed that, like, we had a step-up FMX, or I guess X Game style step-up lip to start the whole thing, like a step-up jump, and it was kind of hard just to get it over it and get both your, you know, tires down on the ground and drive, and Justin went, like, through a scrub over it and went about 4 feet lower than anybody, and so that was pretty humiliating.
It's a good little photo for your little brother. That was fun, though. X Games step up entry. It should be everywhere. That's such a blast, dude. We need to do more of that stuff. It's killer. I got a couple questions for you.
Let's hear.
Maybe I don't know the answer to them. I might, but maybe not. But, like, I mean, I see, you know, a lot of guys that come up from, you know, young guys rode their whole lives, and, like, I don't think I know a single other dude that loves riding as much as you. Like, I really don't. You know, I don't love it as much as you. Like, I really don't. And I don't know, like, what that is. I would love for you to tell everybody what you think it is that, like, allowed you to maintain your ability, you know, in Supercross, freeride, all the stuff you do. Like, what's the key to your longevity if you're telling it to somebody who's interested and appreciates that?
Well, let me start by saying I don't understand why I love it more than you, because when I watch you ride and I see how effortless, like, you make stuff happen and how good you can ride, and how flawless you are 9 times out of 10. I'm like, how does he not want to do this every single day? But I don't know. I guess for me, I don't know. Like, I had it all taken away from me at age 20, you know, and I was at like the top of the game, like battling for championships, and then did the backflip thing, got hurt, and it took, you know, like when I had the nerve damage in the opposite leg, it took, you know, 3 years to come back. And I mean, I remember just laying in bed praying that just to be able to walk one day. And then when I was able to walk one day, like, oh, it'd be so cool to ride again. And then it'd be cool to ride again good. You know, then it'd be cool to race. And then, you know, got hurt racing a couple years later, had a pretty big one, and lost, just didn't have the opportunities that I thought that I needed to be at the level that I wanted to race. And then, you know, I just started play riding for fun. And honestly, it was kind of a cool little stage, because like Axel was like just coming out of amateurs, and I seen how like talented that kid was. And so we'd go out and build jumps and just try to, you know, just go do the gnarliest stuff that we could imagine doing. And that was really fun. Like, that was like something that just really sparked a whole new love for it. And then you got, you know, Bierman and some of the other guys, and Twitch, those guys are all pushing the free ride stuff. And yeah, it was just fun to like, I just enjoyed it, you know. And then Instagram, you like, you can go out there and like do something that's cool and kind of get some, you know, just share that with people that, you know, share that with the world, where, you know, when I was a kid, I would have killed to be able just to like go do something cool and actually share it. Cause we used to just do cool stuff in the backyard and nobody ever knew. And then with Instagram, it was just, you know, gave you a whole like reason to go out and do stuff and share it with people.
Yeah, there'd be like one Polaroid of you on a pedal bike in the backyard or something.
Yeah. Or some, we went from like, what, we had analog cameras that were film, and then like then digital, and then they'd always change the format, and then like,
I can remember hooking up the RCAs into the VCR and watching your races back. I remember that. Yeah. That's cool, man. I mean, watching you, I feel the same way. Watching you ride makes me want to ride. You're one of five people that I watch where I'm like, dang, that makes me excited to go and just do whatever on a bike, even if it's just an e-bike at a skate park, which you've kind of coined. That stuff makes me excited to do it.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I watch you ride, and I can't. It's not just to be like a whole stroke fest over here, but it's pretty cool to watch. Like, I watch you, and I'm blown away at how natural you are on a bike. Like, you took all that time off, and I mean, people out there probably don't realize it, but I couldn't hardly beg him to ride when he was, you know, when he was, you know, being a police officer, and when he was had these other jobs. Like, he was super busy, and he had a young family coming up, and that stuff all took precedence over riding. And I'd beg him to ride with me, and then every time he would, I'd be like, okay, this is my chance. Like, I'm gonna put it to him, and it never really happened. So it's fun to, it's good to see you back. I know that the ceiling on your ability is so much higher than I think most people realize, and hopefully you harness that same love that I have for it and can show everybody.
It's a new thing for me, man. I'm excited. I've never loved it as much as I love it right now. Like, seriously, I have a better perspective on it right now. But yeah, it was the family and the kids, like, made me kind of like, I don't know, just switch gears. But I'm back. I dig it.
Now your kids think you're cool doing it.
Yeah, my little Charlie, my little 8-month-old, like, anytime, it doesn't have to be me. He likes any bike, like any dirt bike that goes by. His arms start twitching. He starts getting all gnarly. He loves it. Yeah, that's a fun, that makes it super fun for me.
Yeah. I mean, it's a family sport. It's what we grew up doing. I mean, we grew up as kids at a dirt bike track, surrounded by other families. And I mean, it's a pretty, when you look at it in the grand scheme of things, and the other options that are out there to get thrown into the world, being around a family of, you know, your family, and then the family that you have at the motocross tracks, like, really not much of a better place to go. Obviously, you have some ups and downs, and you maybe throw yourself at more risk than the average kid, but then there's just more things, I think, that you learn from and grow as a person and grow stronger from that foundation as well. So, I don't know. I think I'm just pumped to have you back.
Yeah. I'm stoked to be back.
Even though you'll probably take one of my spots out of the main this year, but it's all good.
Well, let's talk about Anaheim, man. What did you think of the track? How did you feel being back? Bike switch. I mean, a lot has happened for you in the last couple of months.
Yeah, I was feeling really good on the CDR Yamaha and had that thing so dialed. Like, I haven't even really messed with the bike setup much since 2018. So getting, you know, I got on the KTM last second last year and only got like, you know, I've showed up and raced Anaheim 1 on a week's notice and pretty much raced Benny Bloss's setup.
And I rode that too. It was sweet.
he's got his own unique setup for his.
Well, he's
body
a lot bigger than us and a lot heavier. And yeah, I mean,
as you'd expect. But you know, then we slowly built it into you know, something that was rideable for me. And then pretty much right as I got comfortable, I got hurt, broke my pelvis, and dislocated my hip. And then I rode Big Hill Jam on the KTM and raced in Brazil on a KTM. But I wasn't like really all that hyped on riding. Just because I wanted to, the last time I dislocated my hip, I only had 6 weeks to finish my real moto segment.
Yeah.
And I just didn't let the thing heal, and I'm pretty sure that's why, like, I didn't let that socket heal, I didn't let everything tighten up, and I think that's why it went out the next time and then caused a broken pelvis, so I was pretty hesitant on getting back into riding, like, hardcore. Yeah. But, so, I had to kind of relearn the KTM, but, I mean, the bike's, you know, Mitch stepped up, gave us a really good engine, and Ross over at Enzo and Yoshi, those guys have been working and doing everything they can to get that suspension, you know, perfect for us.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's, the tether program's pretty cool.
It's getting good. I like it.
Longhorn's putting in countless hours.
Multiple jobs.
And, it's good. It's just, I think every time I ride, I'll get a little bit more comfortable. You showed up and even when I thought your setup was whack, you were still looking really good. And then you look better and better every time you ride too.
Well, to set the record straight, I was completely lost until you got here. Like my setup. I mean, I feel like when I was in the swing of things, like particularly on the Honda, I had a pretty good setup. Like I had a pretty good, you know, mind for it. But, you know, being gone as long as I was super lost. And it kind of didn't help going to the two stroke. Just like having a play bike for, you know, for the whole time, I could have been doing early stuff on the 450, which is super sweet. I would do it again 100 times over, but I was fully lost. And then you show up, like, what have you been doing for the last 2 months? Which is exactly what I wanted you to say, because I was like, dude, I don't know how we're going to get this thing, you know, a little bit better. And I don't think I know fully how to communicate it like as well as you do, as many years as you've been doing it. So it was nice. Like, you saved my deal by showing up and doing it. And also, you know, I don't know. It's like, I love Mitch, and me and Mitch, I feel like get along really good, but Mitch has an even sweeter spot for you for some reason. I don't know. He like, so that was really cool that you were able to line that up and get us back in line with those. He made the bikes, like, turned them on a dime and made them really good. So I'm pumped that you showed up and you changed my whole program. I was on like this level, and then you got here and it went to this level. So I'm stoked about that.
Well, you make everything look good anyways. Even though, like, I rode your bike and felt like a fish out of water, you still made it look good and could go fast. So glad that we can help, you know, I could help tune it in with a little bit of my expertise and a couple of, you know, grease and a couple of wheels, but you know, you seem to ride everything good. But I think it's time for us to go into a commercial break. So we'll be right back at you soon.
I'm Aaron Fletcher.
I'm Christian Craig.
I'm Hunter Lawrence.
Josh Maldai.
I'm Cameron McAdoo.
I'm Justin Brayton.
Hey, I'm Marvin Muskin.
I'm Malcolm Stewart.
I'm Jaden Ferrangis.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
Welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show. I'm Justin Hill. This is brought to you by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha. I'm sitting here with Josh Hill, my big brother, one of the only dudes that gets me jazzed about riding motorcycles. And yeah, we've already gone through all that. But man, like, from my point of view, getting into the season, there's 14 dudes that really on paper we shouldn't beat, you know, out there. What's your take on that, like, as far as where you put yourself? Do you think you're going to be able to chomp away at those guys? And do you have the same mindset I have, like, we're just going to keep building and picking guys off?
I mean, when I watch you ride and when you're in your zone and you're doing your thing, I don't think that there's, you know, obviously it's hard to do it for 20 minutes in front of, you know, and get a good start and put it all together. But I told you going into the season, you could get 15th or you could win, and it wouldn't surprise me. Like, I mean, obviously I'd be a little surprised if you won, but you have the capability to do it. So, like, I don't know. It's a stacked field. Every year you come into Anaheim, it's a really stacked field. Everybody's chomping at the bit. Everybody had 3 months to prove, or, you know, to work hard and show up with something to prove. And, you know, there's a couple of guys that had issues, like Mikel Rath and Chisholm, that'll, you know, their names will be added into that list as top guys too. But I guess you just have to, I mean, for you, I just want to see you keep your head down and just keep making steps towards where you know you can belong. I mean, I know that you're probably similar to me when I was kind of in my prime and a little less injured. Is, you know, I would look at guys ride, and other than maybe Bubba, I wouldn't really see somebody do something that I'm like, oh, I can't do that, you know? And I know you probably have that same, perspective on the guys you're racing against. So, I mean, for you, I hope you can just continue to keep your head down, get your confidence back up, and keep picking away at this field. And one day you might get a good start, gel with the track, and really surprise yourself. And I guess for me, I just want to keep working hard. Like, as I've gotten older, like when I was young, I trained and I rode a lot. And I trained hard, but like, I almost trained hard because that's what I was like told I was supposed to do. But I didn't really like feel the benefits of training like, you know, I do now. So now as I get older, like, I actually thrive on working out and doing things with my body and, you know, doing stuff that I actually feel the benefits of. You know, when you get old and beat up and decrepit, and then, you know, you let yourself go and you have a few too many beers and you just kind of go down that road. It's kind of fun to hit the reset button, start training, and like just see how much better it actually makes you feel. Like I said, so I guess maybe when I was young, I didn't really get tired. Maybe things came to me a little bit easier and I just didn't feel the positive effects of that hard training. Just kind of seemed like an obligation. Like, if you weren't doing good, like, well, you need to change your trainer. You know, like, that was kind of the deal. So, but now I thrive on it, and it's fun, and it's just a good lifestyle. And I just hope I can safely keep clawing my way up the field and not take any unnecessary risks, unless it's just like a cool quad or something that I know I can do that'll, like, you know.
Like the quad you did today, you know, that I didn't do.
It'll just like, you know, get me a few more Instagram followers. Maybe I'll do, you know, I'll take a risk like that. But
yeah,
I don't like getting sideways in the whoops that much. Hitting tough blocks sucks.
I hit two in practice this weekend. I was so bummed. I forgot that feeling. Like, it's just like so helpless. You just let go of the bike.
Which way are we going here?
Yeah, I hated
going
it.
Going left or going right?
That part I didn't miss one bit. But
I wish I just had, like, you know, like, I feel like Trey Kennard was like the king of, like,
hitting tough blocks and not like blowing
he
had, it.
We yeah. got it. His skill needs to be studied, because like that dude could just skim, like, he could blow out a whole section and probably gain time. I mean, there's a couple of people like that, and then dude, there's some people like me. I feel like if I just, my fort guard hits it, it's game over.
Yeah, I feel the same way. Well, remember Ricky getting onto that tabletop? I forgot. You're a racing encyclopedia. Maybe you'll remember, but when Ricky like got onto that tabletop and basically rode off the off on the box, like, everything went flying. It was super gnarly, but he didn't go down. I'm like, I watched, I go, how? I would have for sure got snagged by that thing.
Yeah,
I don't know. I don't know what the science is there.
There's something to it that needs to be studied, analyzed.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I just want to, you know, ride within myself. Remember to just to stay focused, keep picking away at people. I really think that, like, the way I was riding at the, like, the world stuff and in Australia, like, if I could get that level, you know, get that level of comfort back on the new bike and just continue to build my, like, endurance and everything, like, I don't think a top 10 for me is out of the question. Like, that's what I want, and I think that would make me happy. That'd be a nice little feather in the cap. I mean, 33 years old and, you know, giving Evel Knievel a run for all the broken bones, and it's like, it'd be fun to, you know, have some success out of it.
Yeah. Well, and I was watching you in Australia at those rounds. I couldn't really watch them because I was in America, but I tried. And when you know, every little piece that I saw of you riding, I'm like, oh, when he gets here, he's going to be such a pain, dude. It's going to suck so much, like having you at the practice track with me. But I mean, obviously, I didn't really expect the jump to the KTM being so big, so big for you, and I didn't expect to be so lost. So the first thing you rode was my setting, and it wasn't what we're going to end up on. But yeah, I agree. I hope you can get to where you were there too. Because when I was watching you, I'm like, dang, looks like he has that feeling that I know, which is sometimes you get there and you don't feel like you can do wrong. That's what it looked like you had.
Yeah, and I mean, a lot of people are gonna be like, well, you know, Yamaha, well, the KTM is better than the Yamaha, or you know, opposite way. It's not really like all these bikes.
They're all good.
That's what you're riding, and that's where your comfort level is, and like you just. Everything's second nature to you in Supercross, like yeah. All these bikes you can win on, right? But it's just, I guess, between your ears, right?
Like yeah.
The how comfortable you are, how loose you can be hitting bumps, knowing where your bike's gonna go. And me, I just have like a, you know, a long history riding the Yamaha. So I know, like some days I'll get on the KTM and feel awesome, and I'll do things even better than I can do on my other bike. But it's just getting that confidence and that comfortability in every like situation that's thrown at you, that I've just, because I don't want to hit the deck again, I'm like a little bit more
taking
cautious
it out a little bit. Yeah, but yeah. I know it's such a feel sport. I mean, it's a, you know, through and through, even with the conditioning side of things, like there is certain things you can do off the bike that will directly affect you on the bike. And I'm like, that's a big thing. Like when you got here, I'm like, hey, come over to Charles's with me. And I'm like super, you know, like dialed in with my off the bike program. I just throw you in first day
and just smoke,
you know, just make you like hate the next day on the bike, which was kind of my plan. But yeah, so I get that too. Like, and you got so many, you know, mountain of different feels when you showed up here. And that was like, I didn't really expect it. I kind of thought like, oh, I'm going to be behind when you show up. And then, you know, there's an adjustment with you getting your comfort back there. But, I mean, I was, in my defense, you know, I was trying hard to be ready when you got here. Like, I didn't want to show up and have you show up and beat on me. That's for sure.
Well, that's the fun thing, man. It's like, we're here to do it. We both just want to build each other up. Like, I think there's nobody that's probably each other's biggest fans than us. I know, like, when you were having that success and 2017, that's the year, right? Yeah, 2017, and I was working at Monster. I mean, like, those watching you succeed was almost more of a good feeling than succeeding myself, you know, because I got to really, like, soak it all in, and that was really cool. So, I mean, it's the same way, even though we're racing against each other. Like, obviously, if I have a chance to put it to you, I'm going to, because that's going to, you know, give me a little bargaining power.
You'll
around
just
the house,
do it for the Instagram stories anyway. So.
But nah, I mean, all in all, like, I think we're both just here to see each other's success and, you know, pump up all the sponsors, all the guys that stepped up to help this program on the Team Tedder Racing, you know, Mountain Motorsports, Monster Energy, Pro Circuit, Enzo, Dunlop. I mean, the list goes on, and it's cool that at this stage in our career, we still have people that are willing to invest in us to go racing and want to see us do good. And just got to give it all. Give them our all to, you know, try to at least get on TV a couple of times and stoke them out.
Yeah. I'm stoked about this deal just because, like, you know, when I tried to re-enter the sport last time, I wasn't really pumped about, like, my situation. And to think that, you know, sitting another year out, and then coming back to a program that's pretty legit, like now I'm really, really happy. Everything's come together pretty well with the Tedder deal. I'm stoked, but I didn't see that coming. I didn't see myself getting another opportunity on a bike that's good enough to do it. And that just kind of came together as I'm swinging hammers in Wyoming and not really knowing what I'm going to do anything.
And that's
surprising.
Back to your last year. So last year, a lot of people don't know, but Justin was training to make a comeback last year on the PRMX team and had a big crash. And for whatever reason, it seemed like you got, like, everybody's tried to say that you didn't want to race and you just, like, were collecting a paycheck and not racing. So why don't you break, like set the record straight on that? Because I kept hearing that for all last year and knew the situation you were in. And, you know, I'm not the type of person that wants to start, like, you know, going at what other people are saying about stuff, but it was pretty annoying.
So yeah, and you know how I am about the media. Like, once something gets in there and it just takes off, like, I don't pay no attention to it, or, you know, I don't care very much. But, like, yeah, I mean, from my perspective, it took me until really right before Hill Jam to even be, you know, able to ride again. Like, I lost, you know, this is gonna be gross on camera, but so like that, I don't have that ligament that holds my AC joint down anymore. So that was a huge deal for me with my left shoulder. I had, you know, when the swelling went down and I was able to get mobility out of it, that was one thing. But by the time that came around, Supercross was almost over. And then it came to the strength part, and I couldn't pick up a gallon of milk with my left arm. So it was a brutal recovery. So the whole thing about me just not wanting to come back and ride was, yeah, that's inaccurate. Like, it was a really brutal deal. You know, the paycheck thing is like, yeah, I mean, and it was the opposite, but whatever. Like, I don't like to trash people, dude. But like, you know, at the end of the day, what hurt me more is that I did invest my time, you know, in every way on that deal. Like, I was trying to be helpful. Like, I was trying to take the role of, like, you know, the leader, and be, you know, because I'm the old guy of the crew, right? So I was trying to do that, and I really wanted to see everybody, you know, be successful. I was trying really hard to get everybody, you know, on a program, say all the same things that Turndown would have told us when I was that age, you know, like, assume that role. So I was a little bit hurt. Like, I honestly was. I was a little bit hurt when that was, like, how the story got put, because I put a lot of myself into that deal to be helpful and, like, turn it into a long-term thing. So I was a little hurt. So that's, you know, to set the record straight on that. But, hey, everything is, like, everything's cool. Like, I'm cool with those guys. They're just out there trying to do the best that they can do and protect what they have, and I totally understand all that. And now I think that their crew has improved since I've been there. I think that the guys they have now over at PRMX are better fit for a race team, which is neat. Like, it was cool to see that I left and it didn't all just pile up, you know, and turn into an even bigger car wreck, you know. So I was happy to see that it benefited from things that maybe I said when I was there or helped do. But, you know, that's not my concern anymore, which is good, because I didn't need another, you know, another task. You know, I had a big enough task just getting myself back into conditioning and back into the feel of this whole Supercross thing. Because as soon as I came down here and rode, that first day I rode Benny's stuff, Benny sprung a lot higher than us and the whole deal. And I was like, wow, dude, I feel bad. Like, I got a long way to go. And, you know, getting stuff that fit me was big step in the right direction, that's for sure. But it took me a while still. It was still an uphill battle.
Well, we're stoked to see what happens for the rest of the season. I think we're going to take another break, and we'll be right back to Swapmoto Live. We'll be right back. Hey, what's up? Welcome back to Swapmoto Live, presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha. Back here with Josh Hill, my brother Justin Hill. So, Justin, you know, a lot of not a whole lot of racers get a chance to race, have a racing career, quit, go be kind of average Joes, or, you know, maybe not average Joes, but taking on, you know, 9-to-5 desk jobs and things like that. And what did you learn from that experience that you think is going to make you better now that you return back to racing?
I enjoyed that time. Like, I really did. I've always thought that I was kind of a blue collar guy. So when I immersed myself into not being a professional motorcycle racer anymore, I was almost relieved for that period of time. But I mean, things that transfer over from that are, you know, if you have a regular job, there's actually a lot more that is expected of you every day. You know, like, you, if you're 5 minutes late, you're not just getting a, oh, cool, man, yeah, you'll get it right next time. You know, that's not how the real world is. You know, you definitely have more micro responsibilities that maybe us as racers are a little bit, you know, not held to all the time. And that was, I think I ran my program pretty loose before I, like, stepped into the real world. That being said, there's part of the real world I totally miss. Like, I kind of dug it, but I am super pumped to be back and have good opportunities and do this. But I think those little micro responsibilities that I picked up on in the real world helped my everyday, just by, like, I feel like it made me believe in the fact that you don't have to show up and destroy the world that day, but just plugging away in little pieces at a time is okay. And I got more accustomed to doing that, you know, in the real world. Now that I'm back here, it's a little bit more fun on the day to day. I mean, I'm not gonna lie, riding a motorcycle for a living and getting to show up to the track and just, you know, do what you're good at and all that, is, it's a little bit easier of a job just on your mind, because, you know, I've said this before, like, I feel like we have a PhD in this. We've been doing this for longer than anybody's ever had to study something to you know, have their doctrine or their MD, you know, right? We've been doing this for so long. So it is kind of weird to step out away from it, know completely nothing. You know, I was 25 and I just stepped out and I was like, all right, I'm going to just check out what the world's about, like, and, you know, and learn and be a toddler again. Like, and that is how it felt. I felt so like almost useless. And it was really good for me to then feel not useless and learn something new, because then when I came back to this, it was just like, dude, I know this stuff, like, as if I wrote it and put it in the stone, you know, like, so I feel like that's the thing that transfers the most from just being in the real world, is like my thought of helplessness, like, I don't know the answer, doesn't exist as much anymore. I'm more confident in what I do now than I even was before.
Yeah, knowing that you can just pick up a trade and support your family and support yourself. Yeah, when you're a racer, you don't know much else but that. And then when you're going up, your stock's gaining, then you get injured, have a bad year, whatever it is, your stock crashes really quick in motocross, I feel like. And I think that's like the, you know, it's just a double-edged sword, right? Like, with working a 9-to-5 job, that's what it is. You get, when you clock out, you're on your time. You know, it's like, you can do whatever you want as long as you're able to show back up on time and do the work that's asked of you. But when you're racing, you know, it's 24/7. If you're not sleeping and breathing it, somebody else is, and somebody else is getting better than you. And somebody else is, you know, even if it's, you know, everybody talks about training and all this, but just even studying film and watching old races and just going over stuff and getting a game plan for yourself the next day and preparing every day, you know, your meals and everything. Like, that's just what goes into it, I feel like, to be the best. And at a normal job, you know, you don't have that. But then you also, you start to realize how much time you're actually losing of your life to something that you don't have the same, you may not have the same amount of passion for that you have as riding a dirt bike. And obviously riding dirt bikes is dangerous, and, you know, it's almost like we're just postponing our growing up, I guess, continuing to race dirt bikes. But, you know, luckily, you know, motocross seems to be doing pretty good right now as far as a lot of bikes are being sold, a lot of kids are getting introduced to it, and hopefully our knowledge will transfer into something beyond our racing careers. And, you know, I mean, for me personally, I'd like to build tracks. That's something that I'm really into doing, building courses for people, training kids, and all that kind of stuff. And R&D on new stuff that's coming out, those are all kind of things I'm thinking about towards my, you know, I don't know how many more years that people are going to want to see me out there racing. But so, you know, like that's obviously I'm geared myself up mentally for that next change. You know, I think that if you buckle down and do what you can do, your career probably hasn't even blossomed yet. But after that, you know, after racing's over, let's say hopefully it's 10 years from now, maybe it's 3 years from now, or, you know, somewhere in between.
Racing at 37, oh.
Well, you're pretty relatively unscathed in the big, other than this last shoulder thing and what you tore, you hurt your knee as an amateur. And
other than that, it's been really, really minor. I mean, that was kind of one of the other things I wanted to talk about, like your mindset when you got hurt at 20. Most of us never have to do that. Most of us are like, oh yeah, it's a few month thing. The doc says we'll be good at this time or whatever. And like, that was something that I nobody really gets to, or I shouldn't say gets to, but like, you know, experiences like that what if moment. And I got a buddy back home, one of my students that kind of has that, Zach McGuire. He's got kind of one of those what if moments right now after a big one. It's like, I use you for an example because of what you've been able to overcome from that period of time. Like, I seen you when that happened, and, you know, as your brother, it broke my heart. But also, I don't think I've seen anybody like do what you've done since that. Like, and knowing what I know about your body and what is going on, is like, it's super gnarly, because I know I'm totally dialed, healthy, like in my prime, whatever, and all this stuff is like, I know how hard it is as like a normal able-bodied dude. Like, and you know, I saw in a couple of comments, like back when you first got back up, when you were doing the butt shift thing, and I'm like the dude, like, this is what he's got. Like, the dude can't shift a bike how a normal guy would, even an average Joe can shift a bike. Like, people don't understand that. It's super gnarly. But I wanted to talk about that, what it feels like to take time off with that injury, and like how, like, it, particularly, you know, how confident you were before you got injured, like before you were, you know how your body felt before you compromised it forever. You know, what does your confidence feel like now that you know you don't have like all that movement and all that stuff that worked for you before?
I don't know, I ride every day, or every chance I get, I'm riding a mountain bike, a dirt bike, a pit bike, some e-bike, something. So like that, I think my just riding level is great. The hardest thing for me is, like you said, with just like shifting. So like for me, I really struggle on my starts, just because it's so hard to, on a 450, on a grate, to hold that throttle to the RPM you're supposed to, launch off the gate, hold your bike, hold yourself in your bike, swing your leg up on, and grab a shift, because you have to do all that motion within about 25, 30 feet of the gate, or you're gonna get left behind. So that's the hardest thing for me. So a lot of times I see myself coming from behind in races, and sometimes that's aggravating, but, you know, like I said, the small steps that I took, you know, and back to something you said, like there's a lot of people that get really injured, and, you know, some people show it and some people don't show it and just deal with it, you know. And I think my injury was pretty public, I guess, you know, but, you know, there's a lot, like, you don't know what everybody's going through. So there's a lot of people that are probably nursing injuries for life that will tell you about it. And then there's people that probably just don't even want to mention it. And for me, just this injury is a part of my life. I've just adapted to it. You know, for a long time, I thought they were going to probably cut this left ankle off. And I sometimes think back, like, dude, I should just lob that thing off, because then I'd have been like the gnarliest dude with one leg by a mile. Yeah, you know, I don't know. It's It's all good, man. We love, I get to do the thing I love the most, riding a dirt bike. I get to improve on it, and every once in a while I can get some, do some cool stuff out of it, and every once in a while I even get a result. But before we close this up, when Justin Hill's done racing, where can we expect to see you? Because you can't, I mean, nobody expected you just to quit one day and become a cop. I mean, that was pretty left field, so. Warm everybody up, you know, 3 years, 10 years, when you're done racing, where are we going to see you?
I'm more open to your, you know, view of what's after now, just because, you know, I've refound the love for it. That's how I feel right now. Like, you know, my property in Wyoming, I want to get rolling, make tracks, start doing things out there. And I get a lot of enjoyment out of coaching. I never thought that I would do that. But I feel like it keeps me a pretty good rider, talking about the things that are super important fundamentally and with riding. So I get a ton of enjoyment out of that. I would 100% do more of that at least. I still think I'm gonna be doing something relatively blue collar. Like I like building stuff. I would like to build home. I'm gonna build my house and then maybe build you a house on my place. And then, you know, like, I'm gonna gain more experience doing that so that I can, you know, maybe do some flips and things like that, because I just like to get my hands dirty and build and work and be blue collar. I get more enjoyment out of, you know, ripping out gross carpet and making something that's awful, you know, sweet again. I get just as much of enjoyment out of that as you know, most things before now. So I feel like once the clock's, you know, ticked for me, that might be a big portion of it. But I'm way more open now to Hill Brothers Excavation, you know, building tracks and stuff, because I love your vision for track building and stuff that's, you know, building things that are cool. You know, you get a lot more time on the Supercross game building tracks than I do, but I'll let you do the envisioning and I'll just help with the equipment, so. That's the plan.
Well, nothing yells blue collar like sweatpants and cowboy boots. And with that, I think we're going to wrap up the Swapmoto live show. Thank you guys for checking it out. Justin, you want to get the last word? I kind of dogged you right there.
No, it's all good. No, all right. Thanks.
Thank you guys for coming. In.